Cotard syndrome, affectionately known as walking corpse syndrome, is a fairly interesting, rare mental syndrome. And how many times can I say syndrome in a row? Like 20 times. This person will inherently believe that pieces of their body, intestines, brains, blood, really anything that keeps them alive and in the land of the living is no longer a part of them. This despite tests run on individuals showing that they are in fact actually alive, people will exhibit this strange ailment and will continue to believe that they have already died and that the doctors are lying to them. This blur between life and death continues to confound the medical community and relatively is understudied because of its rarity. But today we'll be talking about this physical reason for this misfiring in the brain. I will also be bringing on Mrs. Roanoke, who will be pursuing her master's, or is pursuing her master's currently, in clinical mental health, and will be graduating in December, or would have been, had it not been for current events. So she's somewhat of a professional on this, or at least a better one than me. In 1880, neurologist Jules Cotard described the condition Le Delirie des Negations, which I'm terrible at French, so don't kill me for that, or delirium of negation. In its most mild form, it's a psychiatric syndrome, and it would be characterized by despair and self-loathing. The most severe forms of this disease include delusions of negation or chronic psychiatric depression. While conducting these studies into the strange mental disease, the case of a certain individual was included and said to be a woman who denied existence of the parts of her body known as somatopraphrenia. This is the denial of ownership of a limb or entire side of one's body. Even though she was provided with proof that this limb is attached to her body and it was undeniable that it was there, much like Patrick with the wallet when Man Ray tried to give it back, they do not accept ownership of it. She went on to say that she was condemned to eternal damnation and therefore could not die a natural death. Due to this delusion, she continued to not eat, which ultimately she would meet her end because of starvation. The disease is fairly interesting, one, as it really shows how carefully and delicately the brain is pieced together, all parts working in conjunction with one another to give an individual a sense of reality. Should one section of the brain be out of line or even working at a decreased rate, this can cause a person to experience a wildly different reality and also block the absorption of information into the brain as a result. So how does walking corpse syndrome come about? Well, the pathophysiology behind it has its roots in psychology as much as physicality. I will be discussing the psychology behind it a little later on with Mrs. Roanoke, but considering I am the biologist, let's get to that sweet, sweet physical workings of the brain, which I personally believe causes everything. When a brain is depressed, this can wreak havoc on the functioning of the body and perception of the world around that person. Specifically, when the brain of this person has experienced the effects of walking corpse syndrome, there is a neural misfiring in the fusiform face area of the fusiform gyrus. Now, this is assumed it may be the cause, but many with this disease of the brain are usually kind of experiencing much more complex issues than just one specific section of the brain not working properly. To expand upon that, the fusiform face and gyrus are on the underside of the brain. So if you take like the base of your skull, it's going to be just above that. And that's where you will find this section of the brain. This area is known to be responsible for recognizing faces of others and of yourself. When you look into like a mirror or you look into a crowd, you can always spot people you know, or you can spot yourself. However, it's not just enough for the brain to recognize itself or others, but also attach feeling and meaning to that recognition. This is why you are happy when you see friends and family, depending on if it's a good thing seeing them, and are much more indifferent when you see a stranger. The area of the brain responsible for this attachment and meaning is the amygdala. The amygdala is located deeper within the brain and is a part of your limbic system. Now, based on the information, you would assume that these two areas of the brain are responsible, and this is due to the misfiring between the neurons, and this is the syndrome. But in reality, there are other parts of the brain that work together. This is where it starts getting kind of a little more complicated. In some cases, it is known that lesions around the parietal lobe of this person can cause these symptoms. In others, frontal lobe damage has had this effect inducing this line of thinking. While physical damage is a possibility concerning this disease, in others, seizures have been known to induce this ailment. There was a story of a man whose brain was injured after a motorcycle accident, and after his discharge, his mother took him to South Africa. He was convinced that he actually went to hell. The heat of the place told him that he had died and went there, and while there, his mother's spirit was tasked with guiding him around the hellish plane of existence that he would ultimately be stuck in forever. There is also an article written about a 14-year-old epileptic boy who experienced Cotard syndrome. After his seizures concluded, he would express themes of death, chronic sadness, and decreased playtime, as well as social withdrawal and disturbed biological functions. About twice a year, he would suffer these episodes that lasted between 3 weeks and 3 months. And in the course of each episode, he concluded everything around him, including himself, the trees, whatever, was all dead. And during these times, he could also experience no pleasurable stimuli. It would appear that depression and bipolarism have their hand in this disease. Depressed neural states are not just a feeling. They're quite literally when your brain is not firing as many electrical signals and is not really as excitable as normal. Bipolarism causes people to swing between excitable states and depressed states depending on severity. But why might this cause Cotard syndrome? When a brain enters a depressed state, say after damage to it or following a seizure, neurons are no longer communicating. With this communication at a low point, this is where the symptoms come from. The fusiform area entering depressed state would mean that physically a person is taking in information through their eyes when they see themselves or others, is then transmitted to the occipital lobe, but when the area of the brain for recognition should be operating and understanding, okay, that's me, it doesn't. And when the person doesn't recognize it as them or someone they recognize, this is where these issues come from. On top of this interesting issue, let's say that the amygdala in this particular person is depressed. This person would recognize themselves, recognize others, but there is no feeling of familiarity to them. So looking at their arm, their legs, their body, they would kind of see it as theirs, but instead of understanding it's alive and a part of them, their brain is not receiving a sense of familiarity, so they assume these portions of their body to be dead. So you are starting to see why everything you think and do, even if it's just a piece of your brain that is shut down, it can completely alter your view of reality concerning your body. In fact, there's actually a story about somebody who had a PET scan where their brain was essentially mimicking the same type of scans as somebody who is in a vegetative state. So why is it some people in vegetative states are literally vegetables, but others are still walking around and talking and interacting? They just think they're dead. Cotard syndrome is also encountered with people with psychosis and schizophrenia. Joining me today is my lovely fiance, Erica, and she is currently, and I think I told you guys this, she's getting her, what is it?
I'm getting my master's in clinical mental health.
Right.
Professional counseling.
Basically, after talking to her, it's not a disorder, it's a syndrome. Mm-hmm. So just remember that, because there's a difference. I didn't know that. But what is the difference between a disorder and a syndrome?
Right. Well, a disorder is something that impairs functioning. It is diagnosable, and it impairs day-to-day life and causes significant distress.
So now you know the difference. But then why is schizophrenia associated with walking corpse syndrome? And why is that, like, not a disorder in itself?
Right. Well, as you stated, Cotard syndrome is not in the DSM. It's a syndrome, and a syndrome is a cluster of symptoms, right? So you have a disorder, which is a whole pie, and a syndrome could be a piece of that pie. It could be associated with schizophrenia, not necessarily saying that it is. It could be associated with a number of mental disorders in the DSM, but it mainly could be associated with schizophrenia because of the nature of the delusions and having delusions in the first place, as well as hallucinations and things like that.
So for everybody that doesn't know what schizophrenia actually does, there's something called ventricles within your brain. And what ends up happening is people who have schizophrenia, those ventricles, it kind of expand and they eat away at brain matter. And one of the places that they're located is the limbic system. So as this kind of expansion happens, it eats away at parts of the limbic system, and that begins to degrade the neural tissue around that area. So, as we know, with the amygdala, if it's running in a depressed state, it no longer has that familiarity that people once knew. So people right. are that it had initially. So when they look at people,
right.
they no
right.
longer, they're no longer familiar. When they look at their yes. own body, it's no longer yes. familiar to them.
It's extremely real to them too.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
So can you diagnose a patient with Cotard syndrome, or do you have to diagnose them with something else?
You do have to diagnose them with a disorder that is in the trusty DSM. This is the DSM-5, which is the latest version, so no, you cannot diagnose them with Cotard syndrome.
Or as it's known, the Bible of mental health.
The Bible of mental health, yes.
So how would you treat these symptoms of specifically schizophrenia that causes Cotard syndrome?
Yeah, so a big part of treating schizophrenia, like any psychotic disorder, would be medication management. Antipsychotic medications, things like that, taking your medication on time, making sure that you take it every day. Or there's a great new thing out in the mental health field called an Invega shot, Invega Sustenna shot, which it's a shot monthly or tri-monthly that you could get so you don't have to keep up with taking the medication, as well as going to counseling, whether that be inpatient, outpatient, face-to-face group, and learning life skills as well.
So also, I would assume that the medication stops the degradation of neural tissue around the ventricles?
Somewhat. It slows it down because schizophrenia is the degradation of the brain over time. So really what it does is, I'm not kind of sure biologically how in adequate terms, but it stops the delusions and the hallucinations and largely the negative symptoms, kind of like the flat effect, catatonia, things like that. And you can experience breakthrough symptoms, which are some delusions, some hallucinations, and things like that.
So is depression prevalent with schizophrenia?
Depression would be prevalent in schizoaffective disorder.
Okay. What's schizoaffective disorder?
Schizoaffective disorder is when you have schizophrenia, symptoms of schizophrenia, and symptoms of a mood disorder, like bipolar disorder, depressive disorder. You can have schizophrenia and have a certain type of schizophrenia, or schizoaffective disorder, which could be depressive type.
Okay, makes sense. Very interesting stuff. All right, well, I want to thank Erica for coming on today.
Thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. Appreciate you coming on and kind of talking about this, because, I mean, I'm good with the biology and stuff, but it's kind of nice to have somebody who's good with the psychology.
Yes.
Because it's a little outside my field of expertise.
Yes.
But if you guys did enjoy, let me know. Maybe we'll be able to do this again in the future, kind of bring her on for the psychology of things. If you hated it, let me know, because I do need to know these things. I'm trying to bring back the second channel a little bit. I've been neglected it because YouTube has been a crapshoot as of late.
Yeah.
And she knows because I complain to her about it all the time. So, but things are starting to recover a little bit, so we'll get back to it. So yeah, just let me know. Appreciate you guys. Hope everyone has a good one. Stay safe. Wash your hands still, because we still are in some issues. So yeah, appreciate it. All right, y'all take care.
Bye, guys.